Louie Carricarte, and I'm the CEO of Unity Groves Corp. and Grove Services, Inc. of Miami. A regular day would involve, we're in the produce industry, so it's almost 24 hours a day. Even if we don't have people in our facility, we have trucks on the road. So a regular day starts pretty early, around 6, ends around 9 or 10 when the trucks start actually leaving the facility. We have issues anywhere from the seed side of it, which is the planting, all the way to the retail side, which is the grocery store. So you have to be pretty dynamic in how you can handle situations. They can be logistical, environmental, just about anything. People is always a big challenge. So typical day is pretty busy. So we were in the insurance business. I actually graduated with an insurance degree, and it's funny how the world works. We had a family business, which was Amadex Insurance Company. In 2005, it was sold to a British company, Bupa, and different culture than we were used to. We were used to a family-run type of environment, and they were very corporate, so it was a time to move. While we had our insurance company, we were allowed to invest in different properties, and agriculture properties was one of them. And at the time, we had almost 100 acres, and basically made a life-changing decision to try it, to test it out. And here we are. We started pretty small and been pretty aggressive about growth. And there was a tremendous opportunity down here, and there still is. So we're enjoying that. There was several aspects that helped me. Dealing with people was probably the biggest, because agriculture, you have a lot of different landowners. On the growing side, you have the customer side, you have a lot of employees. We currently employ around 200 people down here. And as you can imagine, every employee has their family life and different things. So you really learn how to deal with people and appreciate them and kind of understand what motivates them. And over there, we had a similar amount of employees and managerial skills. How to manage money is a big one, which people struggle with. I learned fast, you know, what you really need and what you want is different, you know. And a lot of people I meet don't understand that. So pretty much the last 15 years, my focus has been on everything goes into the business. And we're at a point where we're doing well and it's paid off. But I would say management skills and managing money is the two biggest. Grove Services was a company we bought about 3 years now. [S2] Okay. [S1] That we purchased them. And it was an essential function to our business in the fact that they provide maintenance and harvesting. And what had happened, we had evolved into their largest customer. And the timing was just right, and it helped us increase our acreage in the area and our production, which is critical to sales. So one of the challenges down here is, which we'll probably address in different questions, is there is a limited amount of land. And if you live in Dade County, you know the green space is diminishing, and pretty much agricultural land, besides our parks, is pretty much all that's left as far as green space. So we needed a leapfrog into acquiring more relationships, which means more production, which translates to more sales. So that was the reason. And it had a heck of a management structure, which was great. It has Mark Philcox, which is a veteran of the industry. He's got 40 years doing it. And it provided me another tier of management, which was essential to the growth. We're constantly reinventing ourselves. So Taste of Redland was a program that we did with Mike Huter and Elena Varde. We feel there's been a lot of challenges, and there's a lot of background to this also. Since NAFTA really kind of wiped out our industry, because we're pretty much focused on specialty crop production and competing specifically with Mexico and mainly Mexico, proved to be a big challenge because it's not really a level playing field. And I could describe labor is one of them. They pay $6 a day. You know, we pay obviously way over that, you know. 120 to 150 is what a typical person makes, and that's without their bonuses for, you know, piecework. So environmentally, they don't have to follow any of our regulations. They don't have to follow any of our safety protocols, And then obviously they can dump product on our market at a substantial discount. And then you have another big element, which you read in the newspaper almost daily, what is shipped in produce containers typically. It's usually drugs and different things.
Sure.
You know, and you read that daily. That's not a theory. So taste of Redland, what it provides is locally grown. We're doing what we call is a locavore push, you know, to consume locally. And I think I'm very smart sometimes, but how many millions of people do we have within 2 hours of us? You know, about six million, maybe a little more even. You bump that up to 4 hours from here, how many do you have? So right under our noses, we have this huge consumption and a huge population that wants locally grown, safe, healthy products. The taste is way better, the quality is way better. So we've started doing events to kind of promote that and get the local community involved. Some of it's been through anchor institutions like Baptist Health Systems is one of our big supporters. They started with the Homestead Hospital and their Healthy Homestead initiatives. So we're thinking we're going to create almost like a cult following, if you may, where it makes a lot of sense. You know where your food's coming. You're supporting your local economy, and you feel good about it, and it's healthy on top of that. And if you want to get in the environment, carbon footprint, everything from shipping, you know, historically our first thing was get it out of Florida. You know, Miami's a port city. A lot of cheap stuff is dumped through our ports from world countries, different world countries around, mainly South America, Mexico, and Central America, and to some extent the Caribbean, not so much. So Taste of Redland has been something we've done to promote local, and it's us having to constantly reinvent ourselves to be able to compete in the U.S. with some of the challenges we face. It went very well. We are going to have a sequel. Really cool if you could picture these events in beautiful settings with orchestras and just all kinds of community leaders and just beautiful, beautiful setting. All local consumption, all locally grown, local chefs. It was a huge success. And it triggered what we're starting to see as people becoming aware of what's down here. You know, most people that live in Miami have no clue that the Redland exists. You know, no one knows. Agriculture is pretty much our second largest industry in Dade County, only beat out by tourism. So we are kind of a big deal, but no one knows about it, you know. So it's something that's really helped us make people aware. And get the younger community involved, which, you know, if you ask a kid in grade school where their produce comes, they're going to tell you the grocery store. You know, it doesn't. You know, it comes from the farm. So we do a lot of field trips. We do a lot of interactive activities to try to include people and make them aware.